Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Brooklyn Tabernacle Tuesday night prayer service. We are so happy you're joined with us. And we have a great responsibility and privilege to do right now. And that is to, as you see it scrolled across the bottom of the screen, to lift up to the Lord the needs that you see represented there. They come in from everywhere, literally everywhere. And we begin on Tuesday nights by a time of waiting before the Lord and lifting other people's problems, other people's situations to the Lord. That's called intercession, praying for, interceding for someone else. We're going to do that for a season and then go into some praise and worship, which I want you to join in with. And then we're going to move on to the rest of the prayer meeting tonight. We're going to have a wonderful time in the Lord. Thank you. Thank you.
And he's so worthy of our praise. You're so worthy, Lord. You're so worthy.
When the cares of life are just too much, and I have to drink a bitter cup, when I come to you with desperate cries, but it's only silence that replies. When the wilderness becomes your plain, and I reach but I don't feel your hand, when I think this night will never end, and the darkness is my only friend, still I will praise you, still I will praise you, still my trust in you. When my heart would choose a path of ease, and my soul a joyful song to sing, but you lead me into suffering, and my tears become my offering. Still I will praise you, still I will praise you, still my trust in you remains. Still you are sovereign, still you are faithful, still I will praise your name.
When the days of you ordained our past, and when I have lived them all at last, when heaven's waiting just ahead, and this body takes its final breath,
still I will praise you, still trust in you remains. Still you are sovereign, still you are faithful, still I will praise your name.
Just praise him.
Still I will praise you, still I will praise you, still trust in you remains. Still you are sovereign, still you are faithful, still I will praise your name. Still I will praise your name.
We praise your name, Lord Jesus.
Thank you for helping us with that and worshiping the Lord with us. Just a couple announcements before we move forward. We want to tell you how important it is that you know about our website, brooklyntabernacle.org. And there you'll see a reminder that yesterday, on Monday, we dropped 3 more episodes of the Believers series. And in this pandemic time, I can't think of anything better than to stimulate our growth than contemplating important subjects as they pertain to the Christian life. Faith, love, failure, the Word of God, other Christians. So there's 30 in all told, and we let go three yesterday. They're free. You download them. Look for the Believer series, and they will help you. They're separate from the daily devotions that I do. And let me mention that to you in case you don't know that. We are now in Love Letters from Jesus, seven letters that Jesus wrote in the book of Revelation to seven churches. And because Jesus wrote them, they're all about his love and concern for his people, and we can learn much from them. Remember, if you call, you need to talk to someone, call the church at 718-290-2000. Otherwise, there's the website, as I mentioned, which gives you an outline of other activities going on in the church virtually during this long stretch of not being together. You realize on March 4th, it'll be 1 year. Not 1 week, not 1 month. 1 year that we haven't been meeting together. But God is on the throne, but the Lord is faithful, and there is no plan B except to trust the Lord. And we'll understand it better, as the song says, by and by. We'll understand this whole difficult season we're going through. So now, one last thing. Really need your help here. Really do need your help in giving, as the Lord has blessed you and as you're able, whether you're part of the Brooklyn Tabernacle congregation or watching from some other place on planet Earth. We want you to think about helping us as we cover our expenses, but especially the support of missionaries around the world who depend on us for their support and more focused subject, the feeding of children, the orphanage in Haiti, and all the different things that are going on that are so blessed by the Lord and so much representing the character of Jesus Christ, which is what the church is supposed to be doing. So please remember giving. You can go online, give securely, safe giving, fast giving, and the Lord will bless you as you give. It's my joy tonight to be able to present Pastor Alfred Watts to you. He pastors Cornerstone Bible Fellowship up in Milford, Connecticut. And Pastor Watts is pastoring a church that our church oversees. And we've been watching his great progress there and how the Lord has blessed that work. Well, he's here tonight to bless us. And at the end of it, he's going to be ending, and then I'll get back to you after that. Let's welcome Pastor Watts and open our hearts real wide.
Good evening, Brooklyn Tabernacle family. It's such a blessing to be with you all once again this evening. I want you to know I miss you all so much, and I look forward to the day that we can be back together again. Not only in the sanctuary at Brooklyn Tab, but also I want to invite all of you to come up here to Connecticut and worship with us here at Cornerstone. We'll be sure to lavish you with some good old New England hospitality. And I want to thank Pastor Simbla for giving me the opportunity to once again share God's word with all of you. And it's my prayer that you all will continue to walk in God's health and safety. I want to share a passage of scripture with you all, and then we'll pray. It's found in John chapter 16, verse 33. It reads, "In the world, you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for this precious opportunity to open your word and to share it with God's people. And Lord, I am so aware of my finite ability to do any good thing in the hearts of the hearers. But I'm also aware of your infinite ability to minister to them this evening. And so I ask that you would fill me with your Holy Spirit, that I might minister this word with effectiveness, and where I fall short, you would speak truths into their heart that never come out of my mouth, that we might finish our time together having heard fully from you and not simply from me. I ask, Lord, that you would allow me to speak this word with boldness. You would give me clear articulation of thought, and you would allow every one of my words to be seasoned with your love and with your grace. I thank you for what you're about to do now, and I pray this in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. This past week was one of the most difficult weeks that our Cornerstone family has ever faced. And that's because we lost a dear member of our congregation quite suddenly. This was the young, loving husband, father of several small children, faithful in several ministries here at the church, well-respected in his profession, and dearly loved by everyone in the church. It's a very difficult time right now, and I ask that you keep his family and the entire Cornerstone family in your prayers in the days ahead as we walk through this valley. And unfortunately, this is not an unprecedented incident in the earth right now. There are many people who are experiencing these types of tragedies and have done so throughout this year. And when such a tragedy occurs, it evokes such questions as, how could God allow this to happen to such a faithful man or faithful woman? Some of you may have actually had that question in your heart after seeing a loved one suddenly pass away. And I want you to know that I'm not here tonight to answer that question. I don't have the answer to that question. And even if I did have the answer, I don't know that sharing it would mitigate your pain. But while I don't have the answer to that question, I do know this, that that question carries with it a flawed assumption. And that assumption is this: living a faithful Christian life immunes a Christian from trials and tribulation. Brothers and sisters, that simply is not the case. And when someone makes such an assumption, they're committing a common error that many Christians make. And that is this: they're superimposing an Old Testament theology upon present day Christianity. You see, in the Old Testament, the people of God were under what's called the Mosaic Law, 613 commandments that were given to the children of Israel by God through Moses. And God made promises to the Israelites regarding these commandments. In Deuteronomy chapter 28, verses 1 and 2, Moses says these words: "Now it shall come to pass, if you diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God, to observe carefully all his commandments, which I command you today, that the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the earth, and all these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you because you obey the voice of the Lord your God." And then he goes through a series of blessings that will come to those who uphold the commandments, one of which is found in verse 6, where he says, "Blessed shall you be when you come in, and blessed shall you be when you go out." And God not only gives promises of blessings when the Israelites upheld the commandments, he also gave promises of cursings when they broke the commandments. Listen to it later in Deuteronomy 28, starting at verse 15. Moses further states, "But it shall come to pass, if you do not obey the voice of the Lord your God, to observe carefully all his commandments and his statutes, which I command you today, that all these curses will come upon you and overtake you." Verse 19 says, "Cursed shall you be when you come in, and cursed shall you be when you go out." I hope you can see the if-then relationship that's within the law. If you are good, then you will get good results. If you are bad, then you will get bad results. And while those words are written in this Bible, there's an understanding that you must have in your heart as we leave tonight, that you have to always apply to your Bible reading and your Bible understanding or your Bible study. And it's this: a promise or principle that you find in the Old Testament must go through the cross of Jesus Christ and be found in the New Testament before you stand upon it today. Let me say that again. Any promise or principle that you find in the Old Testament must go through the cross of Jesus Christ and be found in the New Testament before you stand upon it today. And brothers and sisters, I want you to know the Old Testament system that promised that you will experience all good when you keep the commandments and all bad when you break the commandments did not make it through the cross of Jesus Christ. In fact, the Bible makes it clear that because of what Jesus Christ did upon the cross, those who have given their lives to Christ are no longer even under the law. God is no longer judging us by our actions. He sees us as holy and righteous despite our shortcomings. Aren't you glad about it? The writer of Hebrews explains it this way in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 10. For God's will was for us to be made holy by the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all times. That means when you give your life to Christ, the Lord sees you as holy from that point forward and for all times. And I believe that there may be some of you who did not know this to be true. You may have stayed away from God or even tried to be good enough to come to Him. And you failed time after time. And this thought process has kept you away from giving your life to Christ. But I want you to know, you do not have to get good enough to come to the Lord. Because of what Jesus Christ did upon the cross, you can come to the Lord just as you are. And if you give your life to Christ just as you are, He will receive you. And God, from that point forward, will see you as holy for all times. And I'm going to give you an opportunity to do that before we end our time together this evening. And for those of you who have already received Christ as your Lord and Savior, you can rejoice in the truth in knowing that nowhere in the New Testament are you doomed to curses if you mess up. If you're happy about that, why don't you, wherever you are, just say, thank you, Jesus. Go ahead. But listen to me carefully. Just as you do not find anywhere in the New Testament that you are cursed if you walk in unrighteousness, nowhere in the New Testament do you find that you are guaranteed to encounter blessings only when you walk in righteousness. In fact, Jesus lets us know that the opposite is true through the statement that I read at the outset of this message. And I want to read it again, but before I do so, I want you to understand that when Jesus made that statement, He was not making it to the multitudes that had been following Him, many of whom ultimately walked away from Him. He doesn't mention it even to the 12, because He doesn't share these words with Judas. He shares these words with the 11 disciples that were closest to Him, those who remained with Him right up to the point that He ascended into heaven. Those 11 that He knew would go on to live their lives and ultimately give their lives for the cause of spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ throughout the earth. Why don't you just read those words with me as you see them on the screen? In the world, you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. In making that statement, Jesus reveals two truths to His disciples that we can all stand upon today. And the first truth is this: serving God does not immune a Christian from hardships. You see, Jesus was informing His disciples that although they were the chosen ones and although they were going to go forward and walk in righteousness to the best of their ability, and although they were going to leave everything they had ever possessed to serve Him, they were also going to face hardships during their ministry. He was not prophesying doom over them. He was not trying to scare them away. Actually, He was trying to root them and to make them steadfast and immovable. He was letting them know that because of us living in a sin-filled and fallen world, that hardships would come our way. He knew that at one point, Peter was going to be jailed and nearly killed and would ultimately be crucified upside down. He knew that James would ultimately be taken captive by Herod and actually killed, beheaded. He knew that John, the brother of James, would ultimately be exiled. And these were the three that were closest to Jesus. And if you go throughout the remainder of the New Testament, you will find that most of the mighty men and women of God faced hardships in their lives. In fact, the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 provides us with a resume of his hardships and the trials that he suffered. Listen to them, if you would. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 24, he says, from the Jews, five times I received 40 stripes minus one. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Three times I was shipwrecked. A night and day I have been in the deep. in journeys often, in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils of the Gentiles, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and toil, in sleeplessness often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness. The Apostle Paul went through this, and brothers and sisters, listen, this was the greatest apostle to ever live. The one who declared that if we juxtapose the law with the life he lived, we would come up with one conclusion, that he was blameless. And yet, his life did not immune him from hardships. See, none of these lives line up with the Old Testament legal system of if you're good, you get good, and if you're bad, you get bad. On a personal note, I can say that endeavoring to live my life for Christ to the fullest, it hasn't kept me from suffering hardships. Some of the greatest trials that I've ever faced came after I left my profession to become a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. In fact, in 2011, when we were purchasing the building that I'm standing in right now, when the church was just growing day after day, hearts and souls were being saved, service after service. It was at that time that my wife found that her mother would pass away from cancer. And 40 days later, her father would pass away from cancer. And 5 months later, my brother would pass away from AIDS. It didn't make sense. But it was understanding this principle that I'm sharing with you tonight that helped me and my wife remain steadfast in Christ even as we went through those tribulations. Let's hear it again. It's this: in this world, you will have tribulations. And I believe that some of you listening today may have experienced those times in your life when you were walking faithfully with the Lord, and nevertheless, it seems as though out of nowhere, hardships came your way. You may actually be going through it right now. I implore you to allow this truth to sink into your heart. And that is, serving God does not immune you from hardships. And the reason why serving God does not immune a Christian from hardships is because of this. A Christian is a follower of Christ. And Christ gave up all the glory of heaven to come to earth to do the will of the Father. And Christ, while he was here on earth, lived a completely sinless life. Yet Christ's righteousness and his sinlessness and his obedience to the Father did not immune him from hardships. In fact, if you can wrap your mind around this truth, consider this. It was Jesus's righteousness and sinlessness that made him fit for the hardships he faced. Had Jesus not been sinless and righteous in every way, he would not have been fit to endure the beatings and to hang on the cross to become your Savior and mine. And you need to understand, if you are going to bear the name of Christ, you must be also willing to live the life of Christ and realize that you will endure trials and hardships, even when you have done nothing wrong. In fact, Jesus said it this way in Matthew chapter 16, verse 24. He said to his disciples, "If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." In essence, he was saying, when you face hardships or you see others facing hardships and trials like the one that our church is experiencing right now, you must be willing to put all of your thinking to the side and trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not to your own understanding, and to remain rooted and steadfast in the Lord. If you're not willing to allow this principle to grip your heart, you can find your faith shipwrecked. And you'll never walk into all that God has for you. In fact, nearly every Christian on the planet knows the name Billy Graham. But not many Christians know the name Charles Templeton. But Charles Templeton was an associate of Billy Graham back in the 1940s. And they traveled together preaching to thousands and thousands at evangelistic crusades. At that time, it was Charles Templeton, not Billy Graham, that many believe was becoming the most influential Christian of their generation. But Charles Templeton ultimately abandoned his faith. And the reason that occurred is because he carried an Old Testament principle into his present day reality. In his own words, he said it this way. He said, "I was reading Life magazine, and there was a photograph in the magazine of a black woman in Northern Africa. And she was holding her dead baby in her hands and looking up to heaven. And I looked at it and I thought, how could a loving God do this to this woman? How is it possible to believe that there is a loving and caring creator when all this woman needed was rain?" And it would be that thought that will cause him to turn from God. And I want you to know that if this can happen to an evangelist who at one point spoke to over 91,000 people in a four-night crusade, it can happen to any of us. And so let me ask you a question. Are you almost at that point? Be honest with yourself. As you look at the death and the sickness and the financial struggles that have come upon faithful Christians throughout this pandemic, as you consider the many pastors that have lost their lives throughout this pandemic, do you find yourself sometime asking that question, God, how could you allow this to happen? If you're at that point or close to it, I encourage you not to question God in that manner, but allow this truth to be your answer. Allow the words that Jesus spoke to his disciples that allowed them to be steadfast to the very end to be embedded in your heart. And it's this: in this world, we will have tribulations. But Jesus didn't stop there. He went on to share that second truth. And it's this: but you can be of good cheer because I have overcome the world. You see, Jesus spoke to his disciples and he said, guys, I want you to understand that as you go out to do my work, you are going to go through trials. But listen, as you go through those trials, you don't have to allow them to cause depression and despair. You don't have to allow those trials to cause you to begin to question me. Instead, you can rejoice in me because I want you to know I have overcome the world and every single trial in it. Christ was letting the disciples know that not long from now, he was going to take beatings upon his back. And through those beatings, he was going to empower them to overcome sickness and to be able to bring others from sickness to healing. In fact, the word of God says that by the stripes that Jesus took, we were healed. Jesus was letting the disciples know that he was about to endure death upon the cross so that no matter how many times they fell short, that they could know with confidence that their sins were forgiven. He was letting them know that even after he died upon the cross and he was put in a grave, that he was going to rise up from that grave and he was going to live forever at the right hand of the Father, forever making intercession for them so that they would be able to be more than conquerors through every situation they faced. And even when they went by way of the grave, because he rose from the grave, the same power that raised Jesus from the grave will be able to raise them up as well, and they would spend eternity in heaven. And brothers and sisters, the words that Jesus spoke were not only for his disciples at that time, they were for his disciples, you and me, today. So as we journey through this pandemic, if you are a loved one is facing hardships, do not superimpose Old Testament principles or promises upon your present reality. You will run the risk of turning from the Lord. Don't allow circumstances to trip you up. Instead, allow Jesus's promise, I have overcome the world, to give you stability as you go through your trials. When you find yourself going through those hardships, you do not have to be helpless and hopeless in those situations. No, because Jesus has empowered you to overcome every one of those problems. You can now rejoice in knowing that although sickness may come my way or a loved one's way, I have access to God's healing power because of what Jesus took upon his back. And you can pray that prayer of faith and you can see yourself or your loved one healed. But even in those times when you pray great prayers, and some of you, don't let the enemy tell you that you didn't pray enough or you didn't pray well enough. No, you prayed great prayers, but you have to understand that at one point, all of us are going to go by way of the grave. Some young, some old. Jesus himself passed away at 33 years old. But even when we find ourselves at the point where God chooses to go in another direction, we can still rejoice. Why? Because Jesus also went by way of the grave. But by the resurrection power of God, he rose from the grave. And that same power that raised him from the grave will raise your loved one from the grave who dies in the Lord, will raise you from the grave as you die in the Lord, and we will all be with Jesus together, not only with him, but with each other as well. In fact, the Apostle Paul, he describes that glorious day in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. He says, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. And therefore, comfort one another with these words." I pray that this message will bring comfort, stability, and steadfastness to your heart. When, not if, but when you find yourself going through trials and tribulation. Don't question God. Allow this answer to keep you steadfast and immovable and always abounding in the work of the Lord. Will you pray with me? Father God, I thank you for this word. And I thank you in advance for how you're going to allow this word to be planted in the hearts and souls of every person within the sound of my voice. Lord, you said in your word that without faith, it's impossible to please you. For those who come to you must believe that you are, and that you are a rewarder of those who diligently seek you. Lord, I ask that you help those whose faith has been shaken through the vicissitudes of this pandemic. I pray, my Lord, that you would allow these words, Lord, to ground them in you, that they would not be tossed to and fro by every situation that comes their way. Let them know that although they will face trials, my God, that no weapon formed against them will be able to prosper. Allow them to know that although they're going to face trials, that you have made them more than conquerors through Christ Jesus, who loved them. And I thank you, my Lord, that Jesus promised that the Holy Spirit would not only teach us these truths, but he would bring them back to our remembrance in our time of need. Do that for my dear brothers and sisters in the days ahead. And I pray this in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Before we close, I want to keep my promise. And I want to speak to those of you who may have heard this message and realize, wait a minute. You mean God is not looking for me to get perfect before I come to him? He's not. He wants you just the way you are. The Word of God makes it clear that if you will simply take these steps, if you will simply confess with your mouth, "Jesus, I want you to be my Lord." Lord means leader. I want you to lead me through the gates of heaven into the presence of Almighty God. And you truly believe in your heart that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and God raised him from the grave, you shall be saved. Wait a minute, Pastor, is it really that easy? Well, I want you to know it's easy for you, but that's only the case because Jesus did the hard part. Jesus took all of your sins and mine on his back and he went to the cross. And the Bible says that when he died upon the cross, that barrier that used to separate God from man was ripped in two. And the Word of God says that now every person can come boldly into the presence of God, saying, "God, if you'll take me just as I am, I give you me just as I am. And the Lord will receive you as his own." And God wants that for you. I want that for you. And I want to pray a real simple prayer with you right now. It's a prayer that I prayed back in October of 1989. Gave my life to Christ and my life has never been the same. Let me give you an opportunity to do that as well. Can you just bow your head with me? And repeat this prayer. Say, Father God, I thank you for bringing me here today and speaking to my heart. I know I've sinned, but I believe that Jesus died for my sins and rose again so that all of my sins, past, present, and future, would be forgiven. Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart. I accept you as my Savior, and I ask you to be my Lord. That is to lead me out of my old life and into the new life that you died to give me. I believe that I'm saved. I'll spend eternity with you, and I thank God for it. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. If you just prayed that prayer with sincerity, I want you to know that I didn't hear that prayer, but God upon his throne heard that prayer. And he promises in Romans chapter 10, verse 13, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And I welcome you into the body of Christ. And if I never see you on this side of eternity here on earth, I will see you in heaven. God bless you. And for all of you who have gathered this evening, I want to once again say thank you for allowing me to share this word with you. And I pray that you will walk in it in the days ahead. Let's now go into a time of prayer and allow the Holy Spirit to continue to minister to us as we call upon him. God bless you. I love you. Bye-bye.
Now that we've heard the word of the Lord tonight, we are going to have a season of some quiet music, nothing to distract you. But now let's take that word and let the Lord apply it even more so to our hearts. What is God saying? What is the Holy Spirit saying to you tonight? What are you going through? We had the privilege of praying for others, but what is the need in your life, your family, your finances, your spiritual walk with the Lord? Take time right now and wait on the Lord. Pray as the Holy Spirit helps you. Bring your petitions to the Lord. And know this, God's ear is always open to his people's prayers. Praise God.